Now we would like to invite Mr. Yantis Akhadi to deliver his speech.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi. My name is Yantis Akhadi. I'm from Indonesia. I come from the organization called HOT, Humanitarian OpenStreetMap Team. It's basically a non-profit organization based in DC. We are focusing on the use of OpenStreetMap for the humanitarian. I will explain a bit more about this. So, how many of you have heard about OpenStreetMap? Please raise your hand. Okay, some of you already heard about OpenStreetMap. That's good. But for you who haven't heard about OpenStreetMap, I'll give you a brief explanation that OpenStreetMap is basically the project that creates and distributes free geographic data for the world. And here I will explain you a bit more about what do we mean by free. It is mean that it is free to share, that you can download the map of Oman and then you can share it with your friend. You can download the whole data of the world or, and you can share that to your friend and you would not being sued in doing that. You can download like the whole US data and then you analyze like how many schools have been mapped, how many government buildings have been mapped, and it is okay, it's completely okay. The license protect you to do that. So it's free to share, meaning that you can download once and you can easily distribute that. That's why there are people developing offline maps that I will explain later. And it is free to adapt, meaning that you can make adjustment for the map. For example, you want to translate all of the map of, for I say, French into Arabic. That, yeah, you can do that. You can translate the maps. That's what I did several times when I go to Japan and also in Thailand, because in Japan and Thailand, sometimes people use their own alphabet, which I cannot read. And it is much more longer if we want to like make whether the character is the same with what we see on the map. So it will take quite some time. But you can make an adaptation of the map. You can translate the text on the map so that you can use it for yourself. Then it is okay to do that. So that's the second freedom that that we got from OpenStreetMap. The third freedom, or and the last, is freedom to create, meaning that you can create your own database based on OpenStreetMap. For example, you want to create a database of all the school in Oman based on what already mapped in OpenStreetMap. Then you can freely do that. You can create your own database. The only limitation if you create such database is as long as you attribute. You mentioned that the database of school that I use in my application is I got it from OpenStreetMap. So you mean you simply need to mention that. When Apple Maps initially launched their project, launched their map, the Apple Maps, initially they did not give credits to OpenStreetMap. Well, Apple Maps is consists of data from various sources, and one of them is from OpenStreetMap. They didn't mention that, so we asked them to give a proper attribution, which they did, and now you can see that in the credit section, they're saying that like one of the sources for the map is also from the OpenStreetMap. And it needs to be shared alike, meaning that the license needs to be the same. If you create database of school, and then you add more school into it, like the database of school location in all of Oman, and then you add more school that you see, oh, OpenStreetMap did not have this database for this school, and then you add the data into your own database, then you need to ensure that the license of your database is the same. And you need to keep it open. You cannot saying that, yes, it is open. This is the license is ODBL, Open Database License. But then you cannot like keep it to yourself. You need to also keep it open and ensure that other people are able to access that as well. This is the platform. I will give another workshop at 12, I think, if I'm not mistaken, this afternoon. So if you're interested more about OpenStreetMap, you can join the workshop. So this is the example. So OpenStreetMap is basically like other mapping platform, like Google Maps or Bing Maps. So like this, I give you example of what happened if I want to see what is the bicycle route from Sultan Qaboos University to the airport, just in case I want to go to the airport by bike. So they can give like the route, and it can show you like, it gives you option like what is the algorithm, the routing algorithm that you want to use. There are several routing algorithms that is used in OpenStreetMap, and it is all based on open source algorithm. Meaning, like for example, for this one, I use Grab Hopper algorithm. I can use other algorithm so that you can learn on the algorithm how's the routing been done and how the routing can be created more optimum in Oman perspective, for example. And you can download the whole data. If you want to download the whole planet data, this is the geographic data of the whole world. Currently is around 53 gigabytes. You can do that. You can download it from the planet.osm.org. This is basically the whole planet data. And it's weekly updated. So like every week, it gets update of around 1.6 gigabytes. It sounds small, but actually if you extract the data, this is in the PBF format, proto buffer format. If you extract that, the total data would be around 600 gigabytes. So it's pretty big, but you can do anything you want with the data. You can analyze like how many schools have been mapped, how many buildings have been mapped in entire OSM. And you can also download country level data. For example, before I go to Oman, I download GCC states data, and then so I have the Oman and all the GCC states map in my smartphone, so that I can move anywhere without internet connection, just relying on my GPS, so that I won't be lost. I won't be lost in Oman. And you can also download city level data. This is one of the example from the MapZen. You can download a metro extract that is updated periodically. You can use this application in your smartphone right now. You can download maps.me. This is available both as, they're available as in App Store, in Google Play, and also in Amazon. So you can use maps.me to navigate. If you're a tourist, you like traveling a lot, and you want to travel to a new country, then you can download the map of that country so that you don't need to rely on internet connection. And if you like in the middle of nowhere that you don't know, as far as you got the GPS signal, then you can use this application because the map is already downloaded into your device. Other alternative is OSMN. This is also the apps that is available because this is basically based on open data, meaning that you can create your own apps. You can create your own navigation apps even because the data is already there and you can simply use that. So I will give a brief introduction about OSM in Indonesia. Just this is for those who don't know where is Indonesia. So Indonesia is here, we are quite big. There's a Bali here that's really famous. And in 2011, when the project started in Indonesia, the province, district, city, they started to develop disaster management agency, which is compulsory that all this province, district, and city to have their own disaster management agency. There is lack of spatial data. You either need to buy the data or you need to collect it yourself, and that might be also really expensive. And this is very minimum building. In 2011, we have 30,000 building map, but that's for the whole country. It's really, really a small number. And then in 2011, we got a project from the Australian government. The Australian government developed the software called InaSafe. So InaSafe is basically a software that can receive input, for example, in the case of earthquake, and then combine that with the buildings information, like how many buildings will be affected by earthquake in Jakarta, for example. Then we can get the number. We can get the breakdown of how many buildings will be affected, how many apartment, how many hospital, how many school will be affected by the earthquake, and where are the location for this earthquake, and like the estimation for the population itself. So it combines two data, that is the hazard data, like the type of disaster, and combine it with exposure, that can be people, roads, and building, and goes back to my previous slide that the main problem at that time is it's hard for us to get the roads and to get the building data because it's really expensive to get the data or it's really hard to get the data. And people data is really easy. Statistic agency have the updated data about how many people live in the area. But then combined with this software, we know that where are the location that potentially affected by earthquake and like how many water, how many minimum needs required by that affected population and what kind of checklist that we can do. And so what we did in 2011 up until 2016 up until now is that we recruit 8 trainers because to collect this this really fast amount of data, we need to train lots of people. Rather than we map ourselves, we choose to recruit 8 trainers to teach them how to do the mapping. And then we have done 117 training in 17 provinces out of 34 provinces in Indonesia. We trained more than 2,800 participants, and in the result, we got more than 5.2 million buildings. This is by the 1st of January 2017. So how do we go from 30,000 in 2011 to 5.2 million? And this is how the strategy. So there are already available lots of OpenStreetMap guides or training material. Then we translate that guides. We adapted to local context. We adapted the screenshot to show what happens in Indonesia, what Indonesia looks like from satellite imagery. And then we adapt the language and adapt some of the manual. And we also develop our own training material. We also create YouTube channel so that people can learn by video if they choose to learn by video. And then we also develop some of the application in Indonesia. That's the GeoData Collect for the mobile data collection. So you can have data collection in your smartphone. And this is the screenshot of InaSafe. As you can see, it shows you what happened if there's a big flood in Jakarta. How many buildings will be affected and what is the type of the building affected. And so that it will create a good contingency planning on how to prepare to such event. And this is the tool that we use to coordinate citywide mapping activities. And we also develop the communities, because in open source, everything won't work if you don't have a good and strong community. And we maintain multiple social media channels for different purposes, for how-tos, for Q&A, for outreach, and also for the visual tutorial, so that people can choose which social channel that fits them best. And it's also important that we maintain the social channel, meaning that we can keep on engage in this social media. I'll give you a bit of highlight. I think I still have 10 minutes. I'll play a 3 minutes video. So this is basically Jakarta in 2011. So there is not much area have been mapped in Jakarta. In 2012, though, we have Jakarta-wide provincial mapping project. So what we did is we invite the representation of 267 villages in Jakarta. So Jakarta is the capital of Indonesia. We invite the representative from all 267 villages in Jakarta, and we ask them to map their own area by working with one student from the University of Indonesia. The student is from geographical faculty, so they know how to do the mapping, and then the village representative is the one who contribute. Okay, so this is the boundary of the sub-village. So this is where are the schools. So this is where the village office. And this is what happened in less than 3 months. So the data is explodes because the one that contributes in it is actually people living in the area, people that really understand about that area. In 2013, we update the boundaries, and Jakarta as a capital is really a progressing and dynamic city. During a year, there is one sub-village that missing or gone. So apparently that sub-village is turned into shopping mall, one of the large shopping mall actually. So no people living in the area, it's already turned into shopping mall in matter of just only 1 year. So this is a map, and we continuously update that in 2013, and we plan to do that later this year. So this is all over Indonesia, and how the map is spreading and explode. How it happens, surely because we train people in all over these places, and probably, and there are also big chance that the volunteer did the mapping by themselves. So every light that you saw is actually people doing the mapping or updating the data for that area. So all area is mapped, but it's still heavily focused on Java, in Sumatra, some part of Sulawesi Island, and also like in Papua. This is Australia, and this is Philippines, this is Malaysia. In 2013, 1 million buildings map in Indonesia. We managed to multiply this 4 and 5 times in less than 5 years. And this is the story of one of the first complete village map in Indonesia. How it's possible? Because we work with local communities, we work with the local organization and the government official, and how to map one of the village in West Nusa Tenggara. This is just one, an island next to Bali. So the community is really enthusiastic in mapping their area, because in other mapping platform, they cannot see their village map. They don't know, like, where is my houses, where is the road that leads to my village. There is no such thing shown in the other mapping platform. But with OpenStreetMap, they can see that their village is already mapped. And it's really good. It's so good that even sometimes the people put on their names into it. The house of Mr. Bambang, the house of Mrs. Endang, the house of single guy even. But we need to delete that information, because in OpenStreetMap, the only information that can allowed is only information that is beneficial for the whole public. So we cannot put any private information into it. And then this is in Padang City. We have a competition with the university student to map this area. It goes really well. And we also work with the international community to map the city. This is used for the earthquake and tsunami contingency plan. And in a matter less than a year, we managed to map the whole city. So this is a really a good effort in how you can map an area, and you can do it participatory with the people living in the area, so that you get better result rather than if you just doing it remotely. Goes back to my presentation. Yep, 3 more minutes. So, and currently we also have ongoing project. We currently mapping the whole city of Surabaya and Jakarta. Surabaya is the second biggest city. We do this by import existing open data set to ensure that the existing data is already in compliance with the open data license used by the OSM. And then we also combine that with remote mapping through digitizing aerial imagery. So we map building by buildings, and we also make a detailed attribute information collection on the ground. And the map surely will be beneficial not only for disaster management, it can be used for urban farming, for example. We know where the plots for the urban farming, and we use collaboration with Wikimedia in mapping an area and then creating a Wikipedia article of that area. So that will be really beneficial in the future. Thank you for your time. You can discuss more with me later in the workshop or after this talk. Thank you very much.